Hello students, welcome to SGC online classes. This is Guru Rajan teaching you about the principles of inheritance and variation. This is lecture number 5 we are going to discuss in today's class. In the previous class we saw about monohybrid cross performed by Mendel in Pisum sativum. Just I gave you some outline and even we have explained the monohybrid cross. What are the laws based on monohybrid cross, that also we have seen. Just to recall that point in 1 minute. As far as monohybrid cross is concerned, it is the cross between two individuals with reference to one character. We have taken height as the character, and in that character there were two traits. One is called as tall, another one is called as a dwarf. When tall and dwarf were crossed in the F1 generation or first generation, we got all tall varieties only. There is no dwarf varieties obtained during this process. When two such tall varieties, I am using the word such, that means F1 hybrids, they have become the parents for F2 generation. When two such tall hybrids are crossed in the F2 generation, we got both tall and dwarf in the ratio of 3:1. You may recall this point. For here we got two doubts actually. Why dwarfness did not appear in the first generation, but how it could appear in the second generation, even though we have not used it as a parent. First, in the first generation we did not get dwarf, but still it is produced in the F2 generation. How it has been produced? So why it is not produced in the first generation, how it could be produced in the F2 generation, that is the question we are going to discuss. For explaining this, Mendel proposed two laws. And that law, one is called as law of dominance, which we have seen in the previous class. According to law of dominance, when two dissimilar alleles are brought together in a hybrid, only one of them will be expressed phenotypically, and that allele is called dominant allele. The allele which is hidden, which is not expressed phenotypically, is called recessive allele. And that phenomenon is known as law of dominance. When you are bringing two different alleles together in a hybrid, both of them will not express, only one of them will be expressed phenotypically and the other one will be suppressed. That means we get only tall. You are bringing tall allele as well as dwarf allele also from the parents. But the hybrid will have both alleles, but it will exhibit only the particular phenotype or only particular trait only. That is called the law of dominance. Capital T is dominating over the small t. That's the point. Similarly, how we can get dwarfness in the F2 generation? For this, you know, Mendel told that the two different alleles of a hybrid will separate from each other during gametogenesis. You see, during fertilization they were brought together. During gamete formation they will separate. When they separate, you know, they get different, they enter into different gametes. And by this way, you know, because of that separation, small t has got a chance to express itself in the second generation. So how do we get a dwarf? Because small t have come away from the capital T. This coming away is called segregation, or otherwise separation we can say. The alleles of the same character will separate from each other. When during gametogenesis, when it is asked in one more question, please don't forget to write gametogenesis. When this segregation happens, during gametogenesis. So during gametogenesis, the alleles of a particular character will separate from each other. and they enter into different gametes. When they enter into different gametes, they get a chance to exhibit. Both of them, this will also exhibit and small t will also exhibit. These are the major points which we have discussed in the previous class. And here you must know the ratio is called 3:1. 3 tall varieties are produced, 1 dwarf variety is produced. Another thing is, this is known as phenotypic ratio. Why phenotypic ratio? Externally, 3 of them are tall and 1 is dwarf. But internally, if you see, means internal arrangement is called genotypic ratio. You can recall this point. For a monohybrid cross performed by Mendel, the genotypic ratio was 1:2:1, we can say. What is that 1:2:1 means? This one is a tall individual which is having capital T, capital T. Homozygous tall it can be called. These two are heterozygous tall, you may recall. And this last one, you know, it is a homozygous dwarf, we can say. Try to get this point. Tall is 3. That 3 can be differentiated into 1:2. Out of the 3, 1 is homozygosity, 2 are heterozygosity. These 2 are heterozygous tall. But still, even though they have small t here, how they have become tall means because of law of dominance. So here law of dominance is operating. And how dwarfness has appeared, even though we have not taken dwarfness here in the parent, means dwarfness has appeared because of law of segregation. Both the questions are answered by Mendel, and it has become an important first pioneering experiment in genetics, and it was performed in Poisson's ataxia. Remember, Mendel did not do this experiment with reference to height only. Even he took 7 contrasting characters, or 7 characters he took in pea plant with 14 contrasting traits, he performed this monohybrid cross. Fortunately, in all those crosses, he got phenotypic ratio as 3:1 only. Genotypic ratio as 1:2:1 only. They did not deviate from this, what are that ratio, sir? That is the important point we have to remember. When you take height, or you may take flower position, or you may take color of the flower, or you may take shape of the seed, color of the seed, shape of the pod, color of the pod, like that, any character you take, they will give you the same result only. Based on that same result, Mendel understood there is a particular method of inheritance. There is a particular pattern of inheritance followed by pea plant. That pattern, you know, he described with 2 laws actually. One important thing is, previously, that means in olden days, you know, 3 laws were proposed by Mendel. There was an assumption. The first law was law of unit characters, which I have explained you already. Second one is law of dominance. Third one is law of segregation. But nowadays, you know, that law of unit character is not considered as a separate law. It is considered as a general statement by the scientist. So, in law of dominance itself, we include that law of unit characters. I will explain you those points once again. Now listen to me carefully. What are the key points which we realized based on the monohybrid cross? What are the key points of monohybrid cross that we have to remember, which may be helpful for your NEET exams and other points also? So key points in monohybrid cross, or key points based on monohybrid cross. What are the learning outcomes we got based on monohybrid cross, we are going to discuss. The first and very important point you can remember is, parents are diploid. Remember this point, parents are diploid in nature. That means it is sexual reproduction, and parents are formed from the zygote. Zygote is formed by the fertilization. So always parents must be diploid only. We have taken, that is why 2 capital T or 2 small t we are taking. Why we should take 2 alleles for each character? There are diploid individuals. Second point here is, parents are diploid, the second key point we have to remember is gamete produced by them. Gametes are haploid in nature. Gametes produced by the diploid parent will be haploid in nature. What is haploid? Only one allele will be present. This parent with capital T will produce a gamete with one capital T only. Another capital T will become another gamete. Recall the point, gametes are nothing but sex cells or reproductive cells. In plant, it is called, male gamete is called antherozooid. In plant, female gamete is called ovum. In animals, male gamete is called spermatozoon and ovum or egg is the female gamete. So gametes are haploid. Why they have become haploid? Because of meiosis. So due to meiosis, reduction division, gametes become haploid in nature. That is the second key point we have to remember in the monohybrid cross. Third point proposed by Mendel, or third point we have to realize here is there will be dominant character, and the dominant character or dominant hybrid can be of two types. Otherwise, we can say that dominant character can be available or can exist in the form of two things. A dominant character can exist in two things, two forms. One is either it may be homozygous dominant or it may be heterozygous dominant. Remember, already I told you, when we cross tall and dwarf, we get only tallness in the F1 generation. What happened to dwarfness? It has been suppressed. That means tallness is dominant, dwarfness is recessive. That tallness can occur in two forms, either as capital T or as capital T small t, it can occur. Remember, a dominant character can occur in two forms, either in homozygous condition or in heterozygous condition. Remember this point, capital T is also tall only, capital T small t is also tall only. So both of them are phenotypically tall, but genotypically either they are homozygous or they are heterozygous. But when you apply this point to a recessive character can never occur in the form of heterozygosity. Recessive character will be always homozygous. It will not be a heterozygous individual. I am talking about a Mendelian monohybrid cross here. Still, we are not going to any deviations here. Remember, based on that simple experiment, what are the key points we have learned that we are seeing? Recessive character will be always homozygous. What is the recessive character? Dwarfness is the recessive character. Remember that dwarfness can exist only in small t condition. It can never exist in capital T small t. But tallness can exist in both homozygosity and heterozygosity, and dwarfness can exist only in homozygous condition. That is one important point. Fifth point we have learnt in monohybrid crosses regarding the law of dominance. On the other day, I told you about the law of dominance. According to law of dominance, remember, in a textbook as well as in the modern genetics, this law of dominance is amalgamated with the law of unique characters also. So there are three points we have to remember in law of dominance. First point proposed here is, each character will have two factors in it. Each character will have two factors. That is what we have seen in the first point. Parents are diploid. So each character is represented by two factors. That is the first idea given by Mendel. Remember, when we don't know anything about factors or alleles, Mendel identified that and he called them, he understood that each character is having two factors in it. These two factors, second point here is, these two factors occur in pairs, he told. So that means in parents, how they are occurring? They occur in two pairs. That is what we have seen in the cell biology. There are two chromosomes, first paternal, first maternal. Both are having the, what are that, alleles in them in the same locus. They are called homologous chromosome. That is what called as factors occur in pairs. The two factors occur in pairs. That's the point. Third point here is, two dissimilar factors are present in a hybrid means. Two dissimilar factors occur in a hybrid means. Only one of them will be expressed. Only one will be expressed and other will be suppressed. Only one will be expressed phenotypically and the other will be suppressed. That is called dominant character and that is called law of dominance. So fifth point we have seen here regarding monohybrid cross is law of dominance. Law of dominance, we amalgamated both unit character and dominance together. Let me come to the sixth point here, that is law of segregation. According to law of segregation, Mendel believed that the two alleles of a character, whether they are similar or dissimilar, we need not bother, they may be homozygous or heterozygous. These two alleles of a character will separate from each other during gametogenesis. They will separate during gametogenesis from each other. So, this one will become, what is that? Capital T will become separate, small t will become separate. So, that is law of segregation. Remember, six major points we have learned based on Mendelian monohybrid cross. What are that? Parents are diploid, gametes are haploid. Dominant character can occur either in homozygous or in heterozygous. Recessive character will occur only in homozygosity. It will never occur in heterozygosity. So for a recessive character, heterozygosity is not possible. Remember this. Law of dominance. According to that, there are three statements. Each character is made up of two factors. We can call it as paternal and maternal. These two factors occur in pair on homologous chromosomes. On homologous chromosome, they occur in pair. Remember this point. Then two dissimilar alleles are there in a hybrid means. Only one will be expressed. That is called a dominant allele. Then I told you another point. Whether the alleles are in homozygosity or heterozygosity, they do separate from each other during gametogenesis. During gametogenesis, alleles of a hybrid will separate from each other. These are the key points which we have to recall based on monohybrid cross. Without understanding this, dihybrid cross will be a problematic one. So I hope you got this point. In addition to this, in monohybrid cross, let me explain you one more technique developed by another scientist other than Mendel. There was another scientist who developed a technique for explaining monohybrid cross. For explaining fertilization among the gametes, he did one interesting point. That a British scientist, he is known as Reginald C. Punnett, has done a technique. He has developed a technique called Punnett Square. What is the Punnett Square and how it is helpful for genetics or how it is helpful for understanding the hybridization crosses? Punnett Square is nothing but a graphical representation. It is defined as a graphical representation of possible gametes. Graphical representation of possible gametes and possible hybridization, otherwise possible fertilization methods.
There is a graphical representation of possible gametes and fertilization in an individual or in the parents, we can say. So in parents, what are the possible gametes produced and how they will undergo fertilization, that can be diagrammatically explained by means of a Punnett square. Just to recall this point, in the monohybrid cross between tall and dwarf, we have seen that F1 hybrid is tall only. That F1 hybrid has got genotype of capital T small t. How it will produce gamete, how segregation happens, how fertilization happens, we have to see. What Punnett did means, he just kept the two gametes. This is one gamete with one of the, because gametes are haploid. And this is another gamete with a small p. Similarly, let us take this one as the male parent gamete means. Similarly, during fertilization, female parent will also contribute her gametes. Let us consider female gamete is also giving one capital T and one small t. She is also giving one capital T and small t means. We can get four gametes like this. How they will undergo fertilization? In the previous class, I just put some line to show the random fertilization. But when it is okay for a monohybrid cross, when you go for increasing the number of characters, dihybrid, trihybrid means, that putting the line will be a cumbersome process. So what we do here is, a Punnett square method we are following. What is a Punnett square? It is a graphical representation of possible gametes and their fertilization in parents. So what are in a hybrid or in parents, how the gametes will be produced, what are the gametes will be produced and how they will undergo fertilization. This side we are representing male gamete, this side we are representing female gamete. Now remember, imagine, if these male and female gametes undergo fertilization, what will be the offspring we are going to discuss? Imagine now, if this male gamete joins with this female gamete, the resultant offspring will be capital T, capital T. Any doubt, okay? This and this will give, contribute this individual. This is hybrid, the square meant for each hybrid. When this male gamete fuses with this female gamete, there is a possibility of getting a genotype like this, capital T, small t also. Similarly, if at all these two gametes are fusing, that I can write in this square, it will also become a capital T, small t. This is another genotype possible. Imagine now, if these two are joining or fusing with each other, it will become small t, small t. I hope you got this point. This is the way of writing the hybrids due to fertilization. This is how we are representing the gametes. So this diagrammatic or graphical representation of possible gametes and their fertilization or possible fertilization is in hybrid is called Punnett square. Now remember, this is genotype. In each box I wrote genotype. What is the phenotype? Externally, this individual will appear like tall. Externally, this will also appear like tall. This is also a tall only. This only will become a dwarf. So, you can understand that for tallness, I have taken two genotypes. Some of them are capital T, capital T. Some of them are capital T, small t. Homozygosity can also become tallness. Heterozygosity also will become tallness. Why heterozygous has become tallness? Because of law of dominance. Capital T dominated over the small t. That's why this is also becoming tallness. So I hope you got this point. There are four offsprings, possible offspring. Of course, at a time they don't produce four offspring. Any one of them will be produced. But what is the probability of getting tall means? Out of four, three is the tall individual. In this three, you can remember, 1/4 will be homozygous tall. 1 by 4 will be homozygous form. That means this one. 2 by 4 will be heterozygous tall, we can see. Or 2 by 4 will be heterozygous tall. And 1 by 4 will be homozygous recessive, we can say. Or otherwise, homozygous dwarf, we can say. This is the ratio 1 is to 2 is to 1. When you talk about homozygosity, heterozygosity, it is nothing but genotype. This is the genotypic ratio, 1 is to 2 is to 1, it can be called. That is why we have seen that Mendel was also a mathematician. He applied mathematical principles and statistical principles for explaining the biological point here. When he applied this one, no, just he used the binomial expansion here. Binomial expansion means, if you take one of the alleles as A means, another allele as B means, it will become A into B whole square like that, or A plus B whole square like that, it becomes. So one of the allele is A, another one is B means we have taken here. You may be knowing the expansion of this. A square plus B square, or A square plus 2AB plus B square, we are telling. That is what obtained here. A square is nothing but capital T, capital T. A is capital T, B is small t, A square means capital T, capital T. And 2AB means it will be 2 times capital T, small t, capital T, small t. I hope you got this point. And B square means it is 2 small t, we can say. 1 is to 2 is to 1 ratio is, this is the condition, binomial expansion. Where mathematically also it is logical, logically explained. Biologically also this is explained. And for that we can use Punnett's square as a explanation tool for understanding this point. What is the purpose of Punnett's square? Punnett's square helps us to understand possible formation of gametes and possible fertilization chances. Random fertilization, how it can occur, we are going to see. We cannot say that this capital T and this capital T only will fuse. Even it can fuse with small t also. This small t has got a chance either to fuse with this gamete or to fuse with this gamete. So each male gamete has got a chance to fuse with, a chance, not a reality. It has got a probability to fuse with either male, either one of the female gamete or with another female gamete. So remember, this is the monohybrid cross. The key point here is parents are diploid, gametes are haploid, dominant character can be either homozygous or heterozygous. Recessive character will be always homozygous, it can never be heterozygous. Law of dominance says that each character is controlled by two factors. These two factors occur in pairs on homologous chromosomes, and then the two dissimilar factors of the hybrid, only one will be expressed, another one will be suppressed. When they are similar allele, there is no question of expression. Both can be expressed, or you will automatically get the phenotype. And here, during law of segregation, sixth point, the alleles either homozygous or heterozygous, they will separate during gametogenesis. Don't forget to write the word gametogenesis when you write law of segregation. If that word gametogenesis is not there, then this law will be invalid. Please remember, these are the key points. I will give you half a minute time. Those who want to write this point, please make note of this. We will continue. So what is your Punnett square? It is a graphical representation of possible gametes and their fertilization in a parent or in a hybrid. Once it was asked in one more question, what is the significance of Punnett square or what is Punnett square? It was developed by Reginald C. Punnett, a British scientist. Now, in monohybrid cross itself, we shall continue one more interesting application performed by Mendel. Still we are not going to see about dihybrid cross. Let us continue about monohybrid cross with another interesting application. You can remember when we took parents in a monohybrid cross, we have taken capital T for a tall parent. But in the offspring, a tall parent was capital T, capital T. But in the offspring, a tall offspring of F1 generation, if you observe, it has become capital T, small t. You can see here there is a different genotype, here there is a different genotype. Here both the alleles are capital T, here one capital T, another small t. Why then both of them are tall only, but internally they show the difference. Inside they are having homozygosity or heterozygosity. Now Mendel got one doubt. You see, why we have to put capital T? Before going into Mendel's point, we shall see why we have taken two capital T's. Because these are pure line varieties. In the first class itself, I told you, Mendel used pure line varieties for his experiment. Pure line means what? True breeding individuals. Pure line varieties are nothing but true breeding individuals. True breeding individuals means they will produce, they will perpetuate the same allele for several generations. If they have to perpetuate capital T means they must have two capital T's. If any one of them is small t, next generation will get small t in that. So they will not be true breeding. So true breeding individual only Mendel got. Even I told you another point. How to develop a pure line variety or true breeding variety? By continuous self-pollination. So Mendel did self-pollination continuously. Then he selected pure line tall. That's why we take two capital T. Here we are using capital T small t because we know that during fertilization, paternal will contribute capital T, maternal side will contribute small t like that. Now the question is, internally we do not know what is present in the tallness. Externally it is tall, internally it may be heterozygous or homozygous. So how to identify the hidden genetic makeup? For that, Mendel performed one interesting work. That is called test cross we have to see here. Remember, an important 3-mark question asked in board examination also. What is a test cross? Write the significance of it. That can be asked in 2 marks. Or explain test cross and write its significance. So either in 2 marks or in 3 marks, this question can be asked about test cross. Please listen. What is a test cross means? A test cross can be defined as a hybridization cross between F1 hybrid and its recessive parent. The cross between F1 hybrid and its recessive parent can be called as a test cross. I'll repeat it once again. When F1 hybrid is crossed with recessive parent, its recessive parent, then it is called as a test cross. Suppose imagine, if the F1 hybrid is crossed with any of the parent, if F1 hybrid is crossed with any of the parent, then it will be called as a back cross. Remember, it is called as a back cross. Monohybrid cross we know. Now I am talking about test cross and back cross. In back cross, you are crossing F1 hybrid with any of the parent. Either tall parent or dwarf parent you can cross. But here in test cross, F1 hybrid is crossed with recessive parent only. Why we should do this cross with recessive parent? What is the significance of test cross? Remember, when you perform a cross with recessive parent, it will show us whether this hybrid is homozygous or heterozygous. You want to know whether it is capital T or it is capital T small t. To identify that, what you have to do? You have to cross it with a recessive parent. That is what Mendel did to identify whether the hybrid is homozygous or heterozygous. Mendel did the work with test cross. For this, you know, already we have seen an example with the tall and dwarf. Here let us see another monohybrid experiment performed by Mendel only. Imagine flower color. With reference to flower color, let us take one monohybrid cross. Already I told you, flower color can exist in two forms. Either the pea plant will produce violet flower, or it may produce white flower. Imagine. Let us come. Violet flower is dominant in nature. White flower is recessive in nature. Remember. Violet flower is dominant, white flower is recessive in a monohybrid cross. These are all experimentally proved. They too follow 3:1, 1:2:1, everything in the F2 generation. When violet color is dominant, shall we give two genotypes for this? Let us take capital W, capital W as a violet color, or capital W, small w as another violet color we can take. Homozygous violet, homozygous, heterozygous violet. Just like homozygous capital T, heterozygous capital T are termless like that. Here this can be violet color. Recessive character will be small w only. It can never occur in heterozygosity. It will be homozygosity only. Now imagine, I am taking one violet flower, a flower in pea plant with violet color. Its genotype can be of two types. Either it may be capital W, small w, either, or it may be capital W, let us imagine. I do not know internally what it is made up of. It is phenotypically violet, but genotypically unknown. This violet flower has got unknown genotype. What I want to do? I want to identify that unknown genotype. I want to make know that unknown genotype. Now what I can do means, let me cross this capital W, small w with recessive parent. Who is the recessive parent? Small w, small w. So let us cross it with small w, small w. This is violet, this is white. Let us come to the Punnett square. You are not going to do F1, F2 and all here. Directly you are going to the offspring. Let us come to the Punnett square in this case. Imagine this point. In this Punnett square, let me take male gametes here, capital W and small w here. Female gamete this side, small w, that is white. We are taking. What will be the resulting individuals? Gamete should be circled. What will be the resulting fertilization? If these two are mating, if, I am using the word if, because we do not know what is the condition. It is a possibility. If there is a chance for these two gametes to meet, they will become capital W, small w. If these two are meeting, small w. If this and this are joining, it will be like this. And here, small w, small w. Please listen, what will be the phenotype of them? according to law of dominant, this flower will become violet, this flower will become white, because it is homozygous recessive. According to law of dominance, this will also become violet, this will become white. So what we can say is, this cross will produce one violet and one white individual, or otherwise 1:1 ratio we can get. So in this cross we are getting 1:1 ratio. When if at all this is a heterozygous hybrid, if this is heterozygous, it will give 1:1 ratio. Let us come to homozygosity. Imagine if the parent is homozygous, capital W, capital W. We are crossing it with a white plant. That means small w, small w. Let me write the Punnett square here. There is no place. Okay. Just let us go for the Punnett square here. Imagine in this Punnett square, let us take capital W like this, and here small w here. Imagine this point. What will be the offspring? If these two gametes fuse, we will get capital W, small w. If these two are joining, we will get capital W, small w. Is it or not? Here also capital W, small w. Here also capital W, small w. What are the resulting offspring? According to law of dominance, this is also violet, this is also violet, and here also violet, here also violet. All the four individuals are violet flower only. There is no chance for getting white flower at all. Try to get this point. All are violet. No white is produced here. So what you can understand? By seeing the ratio, you can say whether the given violet flower is heterozygous or homozygous. Do you understand this point? I have taken a violet flower. Its phenotype is violet, but its genotype I do not know. Why? It may be heterozygous or it may be homozygous, because genotype is internal. We cannot see it. Then how to identify that homozygosity or heterozygosity? For that we have to perform a test cross. What is the test cross? It is the cross between the hybrid with its recessive parent. I am giving you a violet plant, imagine violet flower producing plant. And I am asking you to find out whether that violet color is due to homozygosity or heterozygosity. That's the question. How will you find out? You cross it with white flower. When you cross it with white flower, if you get 1:1 ratio, the flower I gave to you is heterozygous. Are you getting? 1:1 ratio will show that it is heterozygous hybrid. When you cross it with a white flower, if you get all violet flower only, there is no white flower at all, then you can say that the given flower is homozygosity. Are you getting this point? So if the hybrid is homozygous, what offspring it will produce due to test cross? If the hybrid is homozygous, during test cross, it will produce 100% dominant character only. If the hybrid is heterozygous, what offspring they will produce in test cross? They will be in 50-50. 50% will be violet, 50% will be white. So please remember, by seeing the children, we are identifying the genotype of the parent. By seeing the offspring, we are identifying the homozygosity or heterozygosity of the parent. If the parent is heterozygous, it will produce both dominant and recessive character in 1:1 ratio. If the parent is homozygous, it will produce only dominant variety, no heterozygous, no dwarf variety. When there is no dwarf variety, it shows it is homozygous. When there is both dominant and recessive variety in the offspring, we show it is a heterozygous. Please remember, I am not doing 10 steps here. I am doing only one generation. It is not a F2 generation. It is the same cross only, only one cross. But in monohybrid cross, we went up to F2 generation. This is only F1 generation, we can say. So by seeing the offspring, not by seeing the grandchildren, just by seeing the children, you can say whether the parent is homozygous or heterozygous. What is the cross of that, what is the name of that cross? It is called test cross. How will you define the word test cross? It is the cross between F1 hybrid with unknown genotype with the recessive parent. F1 hybrid of unknown genotype can be crossed with a recessive parent and we can find out whether it is heterozygous or homozygous. Please make note of this point. In your textbook, they have given flower color as an example. So I have taken flower color. If you are interested, same thing you can use with capital T, small t also. Heterozygous capital T, small t you take. Here small t you take. You will get 1:1 ratio there also. If you take capital T and cross it with small t, you will get all tall only. So it is depending on your condition. Test cross, you just make note of it. Very important 3-mark question. Test cross is a hybridization cross between F1 hybrid with its recessive parent. What is the significance? It is used for identifying whether it is homozygous or heterozygous individual. Just to make note of this. Okay, students, today I told you the 7 key points related to monohybrid cross. Then we have seen what is a test cross and what is its significance here. In the next class, we shall continue about deviations of Mendelian laws. You know, in pea plant, we got 3:1 law of dominance, segregation, everything. But in some other plant, they need not obey Mendelian principle. There are other way of Mendelian laws or Mendelian principle. So other way of principles of inheritance, we are going to discuss from the next class. They are called deviation from Mendelism. After 1900, those experiments were started to occur. Before 1865 like that, Mendel proposed all these laws. So, we shall continue this lesson in the later classes. Thank you.